Welcome to the series on F-Sharp, where we're going over concepts to help you get started building F-Sharp applications. In this video, we're going to be taking a look at how you can create and work with collections in F-Sharp. As a reminder, any code that you see in this video can be found at aka.ms/fsharp-101-samples. Let's get started. So, what are collections? Collections are a type that contains a series of elements or items of the same type. So you can think of that as a list of numbers or a list of customers. Now in this case, I'm using the word list as more of a general term to refer to a collection of items. But in F-Sharp, there's actually many different collection types, one of which happens to be a list. Now while they're all basically very similar in the sense that they just contain items, they vary slightly. Let's take a look at what some of those differences are. First of all, you have a list, which is an ordered series of elements. Then you have an array, which is fixed size, and provides easy access. You just need to refer to the index of an element, and that's how you're able to access it. And it can be multidimensional, so you can have a 2, 3, or even a 4-dimensional array. Then you have a sequence whose elements are generated as they're needed. So this can be a really good option when you're working with very large collections. Then you have a map. Now a map contains key value pairs, and in order to get its values, you have to refer to them by their key. And then finally, you have a set, which is just a collection that contains unique or distinct items. Now, all of these collections are immutable, with the exception of the array. With the array, you can update or change the values inside of elements at a specific index. Now, before we take a look at some code, I just want to get you familiar with some syntax. So let's take a look at what the syntax for these looks like. For this video, we're mainly going to be focusing on the top or the first three from that list that we saw previously. So we're going to take a look at lists, arrays, and sequences. And a lot of the examples are actually going to work mainly with lists. Now, the reason for that is a lot of the operations and the ways that you work with these collections are very similar. So let's take a look at some of the syntax and how these are represented. A list, you can see, is represented by square brackets, and each of the elements is separated by a semicolon. An array looks very similar, except that it also has a vertical bar. And then finally, you have a sequence, which is enclosed by the sequence expression, which contains these curly braces. Now you have a general idea of what the differences between these collections are and what the syntax for them looks like. Let's take a look at some code. To create collections, you can use the built-in functions like init. In this example, I'm creating a list of 10 integers using a lambda expression to generate the values. In this case, it's just a consecutive sequence of numbers starting with 0 and ending with the size of my list. Inside the lambda expression, you can basically do anything you want. For example, in the second list I create, I'm multiplying each of the values by 2. You can also initialize collections directly. In this case, I just type out all my elements. For number list, a shorthand way to do that is by using these two dots. Essentially, it's the same: create a list starting with the number 1 and ending with 10. Arrays work in a very similar way. Notice, however, I can also create multidimensional arrays. Sequences are more of the same, except since elements are generated as they're needed, I can create a virtually infinite list to iterate through. Now that you know how to create collections, let's take a look at how you can access elements inside of them. In this example, we'll work with a list containing transaction record types. These records will have a date when the transaction took place, an ID for the customer, and the amount of the transaction. To access elements, you can use head and tail functions. Head returns the first element of the list, and tail returns the rest of the elements, with the exception of the first. You can perform similar access using indices, though I'll know that arrays are more efficient at random access by index. Using the find built-in functions, you can try and find elements based on certain criteria. In this example, it'll return the first match for a customer with the ID of 1. When I use the same function in an element that doesn't exist, I get an error. To more gracefully handle missing data, use the try-find function, which leverages the option type. If an element is not found, it returns none, and if it is found, it returns sum with the element. You can use the append function to add items to the beginning or to the end of your list. If you need to convert between collections, you can use the name of the collection you want to convert into, followed by the collection you're converting from. In this case, I'm converting a list into an array and a sequence. Now that you know how to create, access, and modify collections, let's take a look at how you can use built-in functions to transform data. For many of these, Lambda expressions are the key. You can use name functions as well. With the map function, you apply transformations to each element in your collection. Using our transactions example, we can calculate tax information, such as the original amount, the tax amount, and the total amount after tax, and return it as an anonymous record. Iter is like the map function. Except you don't expect to return a value, or to be more specific, your return value is of unit type. In this example, I'm just printing out the customer IDs. A common operation is to aggregate or get summary statistics of your data, like total or average amount of something. To do so, you can use functions like sumBy and averageBy, where you're able to specify which of the properties in your elements you want to apply that operation to. In this case, we want to get the sum and average amounts. Filtering data is another common operation. Use the filter function and provide a condition to filter on. In this case, it's transactions later than January 31st. Finally, ordering. Using the sort by and sort by descending functions, you can order your data in whichever order you want. Also, remember that by using the pipe operator and composition, you can create entire pipelines to transform your data. These are just some of the basics, but I would encourage you to take a look at the documentation to see what other transformations are out there. Now that you know what collections are and how you can work with them in F#, in the next video, we're going to take a look at how you can use loops to perform repetitive actions in your application, how you can use conditional expressions to perform different behavior based on certain criteria, and how pattern matching can take your conditionals to the next level by leveraging the power of the compiler. See you in the next video.